Hello students, welcome to another tutorial on mechanical properties of matter. In this video, we are going to start with the question I left you guys with in the previous video. I hope you guys had time to go through this question. I hope you tried it and I hope you were able to get something. So for those who struggled, don't worry. This video is going to start with a brief description, giving you a few key pointers that you need before you work out this question. Now, after that, after we go through the brief description, we're going to come back and work out this question and see what we were expected to find. And then later on, I'm going to give you guys something that you can practice just to help you guys understand the key idea that is going to be presented with this question. So before we go on, let's look at some of the key things that you guys need for you to work out this question. If you haven't tried it out yet, you can just go through the question, read it out, and try to see what you need for you to work out that question, or try it out all the way and see what you find. Okay, now the first part of my brief reminder, it's just playing with a few things that we have already seen. If you haven't watched my introduction to mechanical properties of matter video, I'll leave a link in the description. You can check it out. Okay, now the first thing that I want you guys to keep in mind is stress. So stress, earlier on, we defined it as just a force divided by the cross-sectional area. And then we also had strain. So strain, on the other hand, was given as the change in the dimension. Earlier on, I used change in L divided by the original length L. But for this case, instead of using change in L, I'm going to use X. It doesn't really matter what I'm using here. All I'm saying is this is my change in length X, and then this is my original length X. So from here, Young's modulus was then defined as the ratio of the stress to the strain. Now, of course, if you make the substitution of what stress and what strain is, you can see that this becomes F over A divided by change in X over X. This can quickly be written as Fx divided by the cross-sectional area A multiplying the change in X. So this is just the same equation expressed in different ways. So depending on what you're given, you should be able to play around with this equation and write the required version. So let me play with it a little bit so that you guys can see some of the things that can arise from here. So if I start with this part, I can say strain is equal to stress divided by Young's modulus. So if I know, if I substitute my expression for strain, we can say that the change in X divided by X is equal to stress divided by Young's modulus. So if I eliminate the X from down here, this then becomes change in X is equal to that dimension X, or that value X, multiplying the stress divided by the Young's modulus. I'm going to hold on to this equation and I'm going to assign it to be my equation one. Now again, I pick my definition of Young's modulus. Now I'm going to relate this part to the last part. And what you guys quickly see is that if I tried first, okay, we can get the equation the way it is. That is Fx over the cross-sectional area, the change in X. If we make F the subject of the formula, this equation quickly becomes F is equal to Young's modulus multiplying A divided by X, and this multiplies the change in X. So I'm going to hold on to this equation as well. And I'm going to label it equation two. Now, with this in mind, what I'm going to do is, let's look at what happens. The key thing that I wanted you guys to just keep in mind, the key thing I actually wanted you guys to be reminded of. Now, think about a material that is kind of rigid. You can think about this to be a rod, or just some solid, or a beam, or just something, or even a bone in this case. So if this is fixed at some point this side, and then you try to apply a force this side, So you see, this force is a compressing force. It's kind of trying to compress this material. I hope you guys are getting an idea of where I'm going with this. This is deriving us to what Hooke's law is all about, because regardless of what this material is, under the influence of a force here, it kind of is going to be compressed. For solids, the compression might be very, very small for us to observe them, but all we're saying is it is going to be compressed. If the force is large enough, the material might behave like a spring. In that case, Hooke's law and everything that we have to remember about springs will come back to apply. But of course, this behavior is not really exactly easy to look at as it was when you're looking at springs. But we have to keep in mind that a spring as well, it's made out of a metal. The only thing is for it, it's easy to actually observe the extension, to observe the compression. But for a strict solid, something like a rod, it's very hard to even imagine it being compressed. But here we're saying is it is going to be compressed. Now, just as we saw when dealing with springs, some springs will be compressed more, some springs will be compressed less. And what determines how they are compressed? Well, we'll look at what that is exactly. But Hooke's law came up with the law. Hooke's law, what it actually gives us is the relationship between the compression that actually occurs and the load that is actually applied. So of course, in the original definition of Hooke's law, what we are actually seeing is this force is not a compression force, it is actually a force that is kind of more like stretching this spring. So in the definition, what we're saying is the extension of this spring is going to be directly proportional to the load applied. So if the load applied is F, then its extension is going to be directly proportional to that load. So if you change the proportionality symbol, then this becomes equal to change in X, and then the constant of proportionality becomes a constant K. Now this is the proportionality symbol. Now, of course, whenever we have something like this, sometimes you find that Hooke's law will be defined with a negative there, just to more like to account for what happens in terms of the changes in X here. But of course, for this calculation, I'm going to leave out this negative. We're not going to work with it. All we want to see is, of course, it won't really affect anything. The only thing that the negative does is it kind of shows you the direction of what is happening. But in this case, we don't really want to see the direction. All we're trying to do is to account for how the values are changing. But you guys, you recall what Hooke's law is, you recall what the definition is. So you can keep that negative for some calculation. Okay, now with this in mind, I'd like you guys to compare one thing here. Compare this equation. If I labeled this equation as equation 3, compare this equation to equation 2. Let me bring them both into focus. I want you guys to see the similarities. I want you guys to see if you can make a conclusion. So try to pause the video. Identify the sections that are similar and try to see if you can make or if you can draw one conclusion when you compare equation 3 to equation 2. So try to pause the video and observe this. Okay, so I hope you actually did try to make a comparison. But from this observation, you notice that the left-hand side is all force F. So the right-hand side, on the other hand, you have change in X. What remains, the coefficient of the change in X in equation 2 obviously has to be equal to the coefficient of the change in X in equation 3, implying that the constant K here has to be equivalent to YA divided by X. So I'm going to get this as my equation 4. So I hope you guys were able to make that conclusion. Okay, now the last thing that I want you guys to just keep in mind is, just to remind you of, is how do you actually get the energy absorbed by a loaded spring? or by a compressed spring. Here we talked about a spring being compressed, the spring being stretched. Now, if you are going to stretch a spring, let's say you apply a compression force, a compressing force here, the spring can be compressed to some degree. And when you remove this force, it's like you've stored some energy in the spring. That energy can be used to do work. It can be used to push a block. It can be used to, literally, it can be used to do different things. Now, how do you actually account for the energy stored in the spring or the energy absorbed by a compressed spring? Now, how do you account for that? If I use S, so I'm using this to imply the absorbed energy. So the energy absorbed by a spring. Now, how do you account for that? So I hope you guys remember this equation as well. It's something that you probably did in lower grades. So this is going to be given by half K change in X squared. So this is one equation that we are going to need, that you guys actually need to keep in mind having gone through these topics. So in this equation, again, the K here is the spring constant, since this is the spring. How much energy it gets to store, of course, depends on that value of K. Then apart from that, this is how much that spring has been compressed. So this is the equation that we're going to need to calculate the energy stored in a spring, a compressed spring, that is. So we're going to label this as equation 5. Now, having seen all this, we can then go ahead and look at the question that I left you guys with in the previous video. So reading through the question, I'll let you guys, you can pause the question, the video, and try to read through as many times as you need. I'll advise you to read it at least twice. The first time, try to get a feel of what the question is at every point. And then the second part, now you're trying to get what the question actually gives you. But I hope, having gone through that reminder, that bit to remind you, I hope you are able to work out both part A and part B. So I'll ask you guys to just pause the video and try to work it out using the concepts I just ran you through just now. Okay, so I hope you did have time to try it out. Otherwise you can go right ahead and see how you are supposed to work it out. So let's look at part A. Probably before we even look at part A, let's look at what we are actually given in this question. So you guys can have this question somewhere so that as we go through this, you're also able to refer to the question. So the first part is saying we have a bone that has a Young's modulus. So they're giving us the Young's modulus of the bone. I'm using Y to mean Young's modulus here. The Young's modulus is given as 18 by 10 to the power 9 pascals. So here, this Young's modulus, the question doesn't specify whether it is what kind of bone here. So we're going to go right ahead and say, okay, this is the Young's modulus of every bone that we're going to deal with in this question. So again, it doesn't specify which bone this Young's modulus is for. So we are assuming it is the Young's modulus of every bone. So look out for questions that you might be given. Sometimes they might specify that, okay, this bone has this Young's modulus and this bone has this Young's modulus. So pay attention for such tricks with questions. Okay, the next part is under a compression, it can withstand a stress of about, so here they're giving us the stress this bone can withstand, or a bone generally can withstand. And they're giving this value as 160 by 10 to the power 6 pascals. So what does this mean? If you look at how it ends, it can withstand this stress before breaking. So what it means is any stress greater than this value, the bone breaks. Any stress less than this value, the bone is fine. Okay, now how can we use this? Let's quickly go to the first part, part A. So in part A, the question is, assume that a femur, so now we're specifying a bone we're dealing with. So in part A, we're dealing with the femur. So I'm just going to put that right up here. And they give us the length. So they're saying a femur, that is a thigh bone, is 0.5 meters long. So I'm using x to mean my length. This is given as 0.5 meters. And calculate the amount of compression this bone can withstand before breaking. So the compression, for compression, I'm looking at change in x before the bone breaks. So before the bone breaks, I kind of want to get that compression that kind of borders about this stress. So because this is the limit before the bone breaks. So I want to know the compression when the stress is that value. So we're quickly going to refer back to the equations we just derived, and we're going to pick equation one. And equation one kind of relates that compression to the stress and the original dimension to the Young's modulus. So since I already went through how to derive these equations, I don't have to really go through all that week. I hope you guys were able to follow from there. If you're not sure, you can just go back and watch that extra bit. So from equation one, I can just keep that change in x is equal to the original dimension of the femur multiplying the stress divided by the Young's modulus of the bone. Again, that Young's modulus is general. I'm taking it to be general for the bone. So I'm saying it's the Young's modulus of the femur for now. So the original dimension of the femur is 0.5. The stress of the femur is given of not, yeah, the stress before breaking. So meaning this becomes the stress of the femur for now is 160 by 10 to the power 6 pascals divided by the Young's modulus. That's 18 by 10 to the power 9. This is also in pascals. So if you work out this this calculation, you should be able to get the value of change in x as 4.44 by 10 to the power negative 3 meters. You can leave it in this form, or you can write it as 4.44 in millimeters. Okay, so you guys should be able to convert easily from this from meters to millimeters. So this was all part A. It was very straightforward. I hope you guys were able to use the equations I derived to get this value. I hope when you pause the video to try it out, you're able to find this value. So let's quickly go to the second part. This is the more interesting one. I hope you guys were also able to pull it out, seeing that I actually literally derived all the equations you needed. Okay, but let's look at the science that is happening here. For this part now, we're assuming that we have a 50 kg runner. So the mass of the runner here is given as 50 kgs. So this runner trips and falls on his extended hand. If the bones of one arm absorb all the kinetic energy, neglecting the energy of the fall, what is the minimum speed of the runner that will cause a fracture of the arm? Assume that the length of the arm is 1 meter and the area of the bone is 4 centimeters. So we're taking that 4 centimeters to be, of course, centimeter squared, since that is area. So the length of the arm, we're taking it to be 1 meter, and the area of the arm, we're taking it to be 4 centimeters squared. Okay. Now, one key thing when you're reading this question is you see they've given you the mass. As you go on, you see that they're talking about if the bones of one arm absorb all the kinetic energy. Once I see the question mention kinetic energy, I quickly want to look at what kinetic energy is. I just want to hold on to that part. I don't know how I'm going to use it, but for now, I just want to say, okay, kinetic energy is given by that. And then next up, they're saying all the kinetic energy is absorbed by the arm. Now, if you treat the arm as a spring, so we're taking this arm as something that behaves like a spring, or the bones of the arm to behave like a spring. So we're saying this arm absorbs all that kinetic energy. So it absorbs all that kinetic energy. Now, the question is, how do we account for the absorbed energy? Again, how do you account for the energy of a loaded spring or compressed spring? Because if it's going to absorb, then most likely That force will cause compression of the arm, meaning it's like we're compressing a spring. So I hope you get the idea now. It's like all this kinetic energy has to become absorbed energy by a spring, meaning it becomes half k change in x squared, where the change in x is the compression that occurs and the k is the constant there. You can think about it as it's literally the spring constant, but here we're talking about the arm. So taking the arm to be this entire thing that we're working with here. So if you look at what this is, now I have half mv squared, the kinetic energy of the runner, divided equal to half ke change in x squared. So this is the equation that we are going to play around with. You see, in brackets, this question kind of says neglecting the energy of the force. That condition is very important. It kind of simplifies this question. Without that condition, this question would have been a lot more complicated because we'd have to think about the torques that come with the person falling, because if a person trips, they kind of behave as if they are rotating. And the question literally just becomes more complicated there. So we want to ignore what happens when they're falling. All we want to compare is the kinetic energy they had while they are running. All of it becomes absorbed by the arm. That's what this equation kind of implies. So if we simplify this, the 1 over 2 cancels from both sides. And what we now notice is we now have m v squared is equals to k change in x squared. So from here, we see that the question gives us what the mass is. We want to find what the velocity is, but we kind of need to know what this is, and we need to know what this is. So this is a spring. We're taking the arm to behave like a spring. And I hope you guys remember, for a spring, we can easily relate this value k to Young's modulus, the cross-sectional area, and also the length of that particular spring. So we used Hooke's law to see that k can be written as the Young's modulus, the cross-sectional area, divided by the original dimension. So you can quickly go back if you're not sure about that. It's an equation that we derived earlier. We labeled it as equation 4. So if you look at this, we can then use that same equation to calculate what the k is. So again, we're taking the arm to literally be the bone itself of Young's modulus. The value there that we're using is going to be that 18 by 10 to the power 9, multiplying the cross-sectional area. So the question gives area in centimeters squared. You guys should be able to convert that to meters squared by just multiplying it by negative 4. This now becomes meters squared. So with that done, you can then bring that value here. So that is 4 by 10 to the power negative 4. Divided by the dimension of the arm, that is now 1 meter. So k, if you work out that, k becomes, you can write it in scientific notation, that becomes 7.2 by 10 to the power 6. So the units for k are newton per meter squared. Okay. So this is given in newtons per meter. Okay, so let's just verify those units. Okay. Anyway, I think we can come back to the units a little bit later. Okay, so after this, we can then look at what we're dealing with in terms of, I think we can just make sure we have the right units here. So Young's modulus is coming with pascals. So pascals, if you remember what pascals is, this is the newton per meter squared. This is cross-sectional area. It is coming with the meter squared. So if you look at this, this meter will cancel with that. The distance or the length here comes with the meter. So now we end up with the newton per meter as the units for the spring constant in this case. Okay, so from here now, We now know what k is, but then we are remaining with what change in x is. So again, if we refer to our equation one, so equation one, we had change in x given by, so this was given by, if we quickly go back, we just from using that equation. But anyway, I think we know what it is, but let me just show you guys what it is. So we just from using that equation, so this is the equation I'm dealing with. Change in x is equals to the original dimension, stress, divided by the Young's modulus. So again, we already derived this equation, so you guys should know what it is. So this multiplies the stress, this is divided by the Young's modulus. Again, we're assuming that this arm has the same stress as before, and then the length, this time it's the only thing that has changed, the length is now one, and then this is multiplying the stress. The stress before breaking, that is that 160 by 10 to the power 6. And then the Young's modulus, we're also saying this is still the same. This is still a bone. So the Young's modulus is the same. That is 18 by 10 to the power 9. So if you work out this, you should be able to get the change in x. In this case, of course, you should be able to come out as 8.89. by 10 to the power negative 3 meters. Now, with the value of k in check and the value of change in x in check, we go back to our equation, mv squared is equals to k change in x squared. So if we make v the subject of the formula, first we have v squared is k change in x squared divided by m. And then when we square root, we have v. So now we're square rooting, it's no longer v squared, it's v. Then we have the square root of k, change in x squared, divided by the mass. So we can substitute and simplify. So if we substitute our k, we found this as 7.2 by 10 to the power 6. And then our change in x, we found this earlier on. This value we found it just recently, that is 8.89 by 10 to the power negative 3, but this value has to be squared divided by the mass. So the mass here, this is 50 kgs. So here, make sure the units are all correct, which they are in this case. So with this done, you simplify all this and you see that what you get as your V becomes 3.37 meters per second. Okay, so this brings us to the end of this question. It was kind of interesting and a little bit long. There are a lot of assumptions which were made to reach this stage. We had to assume that the whole arm was literally born of 1 meter. And then the Young's modulus had to be that 18 by 10 to the power 9. We had to assume that, but of course, the arm will not just be all bone. You're going to have connecting tissues and so on. Okay, so all those assumptions had to be made for us to be able to work it all this far. But I hope you guys have got the principle, the skills to work out a similar question if you had such in an exam. The tricks are all the same here, apart from the fact that we had to make a lot of assumptions. But I hope you guys have learned something from this. So just to help you guys practice what we've gone through in this video, I'm going to leave you guys with one question that you guys can play around with. One thing that you've noticed is having gone through what the energy absorbed by a loaded spring is, you guys shouldn't really struggle to see how this energy can be converted to other forms. It's basically the conservation of energy. Now we're saying we're also going to incorporate the energy absorbed by a spring whenever necessary. Of course, if you have something that is going to be compressed, then the energy it's going to have can be accounted for in this manner. So to help you guys just practice what that is, I'm going to leave you guys with this question. It is something interesting. You guys shouldn't really struggle with it. It kind of combines work energy and power. with the element we just described about the energy absorbed by a loaded spring. So you guys can quickly read through, try it out. Let's see what you find. You can comment your answers in the description below. I will be able to get back to you or respond to you. And yeah, if you get it right, you're confident what you're doing, you can just share with your colleagues in the comment section the method that you use, so that hopefully they can also learn from that. Okay. All right, you guys, I hope you found this video helpful. If you did, leave a like. Otherwise, we'll see you guys in the next video. This was your tutor.